Welcome to the Link edition for this week. Thank you for always joining us. And I do get feedback on several things that we have here. Some of you, even by extension, have inquiries. Tonight we're speaking about resilience. In the last more than 30 years, Uganda's economy has never experienced a shock like COVID-19. And this COVID-19 is not a drought or a flood or a fire. This is unique in a way. And the word resilience comes back and takes a different shape in some way going forward. The Economic Policy Research Center has done a quick survey which showed that for most of the SMEs, there is no resilience. But just in case you think, what is that these people are talking about? Tonight, my guest is Mr. Charles Ochichi, Executive Director for Enterprise Uganda. Most of you know him, and is here to talk about resilience. Charles, welcome.
Thank you so much, and I'm very delighted to be on NTV, the Link segment.
What is resilience, and how can COVID redefine what we know as resilience?
Resilience from the business perspective is the ability to bounce back, to spring back to where you used to be, or even better. In other words, you are challenged in a particular way you used to do things, but you've been able to reorganize yourself, and within a short time, you come back to where you used to be and probably stronger and better than what you used to be. And that calls for self-belief. That also calls for you to be able to limit the time for grieving and quickly begin to say what caused the damage or the crisis that I've just gone through. And then after you've learned what that one was, can you quickly learn from there and see what you can start doing to get back on your feet? So resilience is that self-belief. Belief for some of the religious fellows is associated with faith. And I like the definition that is put in the religious book called the Bible. It says, faith or belief is assurance of what you hope for, certainty of what you hope for, and believing that what you are not even seeing is going to happen. So that is what resilience really means. It is that inner hardiness of the entrepreneur to say, I'm going through a low point, through a valley, through a dark moment, but I'll come out stronger and better at the end of the tunnel.
So I see that, first of all, it starts with I, the entrepreneur, but let's move on. If we can apply that to many situations, like a drought, a flood, or some kind of shock, COVID seems to have brought a magnitude that many SMEs have not encountered before. So how has COVID redefined the need for resilience? Such a shock.
The beauty about COVID is that it has just equalized everybody. People that we thought were stronger, were able to cope better, were loved by banks, were getting good loans, were able to get supplies on credit. Everybody has been grounded to the same level. Now everybody is speaking the same language. So when a situation like that happens, it's a moment for everyone to now say, oh, so the people I used to think were stronger, better equipped, well prepared, are equally as normal and as vulnerable as I am. In other words, what COVID has simply done is to bring the story of resilience and ability to overcome risks to become an integral part of every entrepreneur. Because risks can be global, can be national, can be regional, they can also be enterprise-based. All those different areas are what I call the folders of risk or sources of risk. So in effect, you must realize that there is no end to getting this kind of shocks, to getting this kind of crisis, but pandemic has made it much clearer, much more acceptable for all of us to admit that there are moments when you can just say, you know, this is not something I knew before. This is not something I prepared, but how can I get out and get moving again?
Okay. So you spoke about, first of all, mean entrepreneur, and I appreciate that very much. Practically, once I can be able to summon myself, How can SMEs reorganize their internal workings to stand up and prevail over new types of shocks like COVID?
The first thing you need to know each time a crisis like this happens is ask yourself, do I still have a potential customer? And be very honest with that answer. A crisis has happened. Do you think somebody is going to come and continue to consume a solution you used to sell? This crisis has told you that please do not open a gym. Please do not open a bar. Please do not open a gaming outlet. So the first question you ask yourself, do I still have a customer? If the answer is yes, is the customer still having the same behavioral buying patterns? Or has the customer said, oh my God, with this kind of new changes, I need to reprioritize the way I spend my money. So the first thing when you get through a crisis like this is get quickly to knowing your customer. Are they still there? If they are still there, what is their buying pattern? What are they reprioritizing? And having seen what they are looking at and what they are doing, you ask yourself, what is my strength in terms of serving such a customer? What is my weakness? In other words, this is the time to invest in your learning abilities. Abilities to be humble enough and say, I have been in business for 20 years, but I must remain a very normal learner. Beginning to learn a customer that I thought I knew for so long, because in a crisis, people change rapidly. So the ability to know your client, the ability to know your ability to serve that customer is your starting point. Once you do that, you might think, oh my God, maybe it is only me where it is darkest. The next question you ask is, was I the only one even giving that solution? What are my competitors, what are my peers doing to cross this dark line? Mm. That gives you hope. That gives you a moment of saying, there might be a way somebody has managed to angle the situation and managed to cross the dark moment. But don't just look outside. Look even inside. Your own employees could easily give you ideas. Mm. They know what's happening in the market. After they serve a customer in your premises, they go back to the community. And from the community, they are talking, they are interacting, and they are getting ideas. So do not imagine that just because you are the business owner, you have the monopoly of the ideas. Mm. You are the bedrock of all the best solutions that can be given to your customers. But with all that said, you must remain the pace setter. Staff are in dark corners and they are looking for inspiration. They are looking for a leader who is saying, tomorrow can we do this? And they are willing to experiment with the new approaches, with the new products, with the new markets. So decisiveness, being a person of leadership and ability to cross to the unknown still remains with you, the business owner.
I like that you have ended up with leadership. And I was about to ask leadership until you answered the question. On the question of leadership, how critical is the mindset of the leader to assail such shocks?
It is almost everything. Because a leader is the source of influence. A leader is the source of hope. A leader is the source of warmth. If a leader is saying, this is the moment for us to use every resource frugally, the leader should be the first to say, you know what? Starting today, we're not going to use a four-wheel drive car to move, even if we have been given a travel permit. Starting today, I'm not going to be having lunch the way I used to be having. I'm going to be talking and taking just a simple salads. What a leader does in moments like those is much more informative than what a leader says. So a leader must not only appear to be talking or suggesting ways, but he must walk the talk and he must exhibit the kind of behaviors he wants to see from his team in terms of the changes and the sacrifices that the pandemic can bring on the business.
Finally, Charles, many SMEs were there waiting for government and saying, oh, government, government, government. And we see that government has its own limitations in coming out to help businesses. What is the everlasting lesson SME should remember now going forward in as far as public support is concerned and they themselves in terms of resilience in the situation of shock?
Number one, they should be able to make their case as articulately, as clearly as possible. Make a case because you have been giving jobs. You've been paying taxes. You've been contributing to the forex of this country. So make your case as strong as you can probably do. But beware of the following. No government has got limitless resources. Two, even when those resources are available, there will be a very long, tedious process because we are dealing with a public resource. We have just seen what it meant to access the 100,000 shillings during the past few weeks that we were given this money. Some people have now not picked it, not because government could not provide for it, but even the 100,000, it was not you who decided, it was government who decided. The ability of government to give you any support is to the extent their resources can permit them to do it. Number two, the timing is not in your control. Number three, you may not be on the list and just live with that reality. In other words, as we live and walk through the pandemic, let us call upon our governments to do many other things apart from just the financial rebates or financial discounts or what I call soft loans. Ask government to do the other policy-related interventions. For example, if VAT has been at 18%, can government do what Kenya has done? You remove 2 percentage points. You can remove a VAT from a whole sector like tourism. And just say tourism is suffering no VAT for the next 2 years. That's a policy decision. That one has got nothing to do with the amount of resources you are waiting for. Mm. And it has also got nothing to do with waiting for so many months before the announcement is done. If government believes in the situation, they will announce it tomorrow. So look at government for solutions that have got monetary direct benefit, but also look at solutions that are of policy nature, tax related, tax holidays, issues to do with saying, if you are going to go into this kind of a sector, these are the sectoral benefits we are going to give you. At that point, SMEs can get some of the solutions that come quickly by government sacrificing taxes in a particular area. By government saying, you know what, we know that umeme needs to be sustainable and make a profit. Can government subsidize umeme for the next 24 months for the sake of making sure that our exports are cheap, our products that are sold within the country are cheap, and what we produce are not outcompeted by countries that have been able to subsidize utilities in their country and therefore making their exports to be cheaper in Uganda?
Thank you very much, Charles. You have been a guest here before. You know, always our time. I wanted to ask another question, but I can't because of our time. But thank you very much for fixing us within your busy schedule so as to be able to explain these things to our viewers. Viewers is a seasoned trainer of businesses, and you heard him. You are going to see him more in the coming month as we deal with the parish model. Is very key there, Enterprise Uganda. We hope that you had useful information that is going to help you be resilient. That was The Link. Thank you for joining us tonight.